Hallelujah.
They tell us Jesus died at 33. No, it's funny, that's the highest degree in masonry. They put subliminals in the word to confound the reader. That's why we need the Holy Spirit to interpret things. The lying pen of the scribes handle the scriptures falsely. Jeremiah 8 and 8, deception is costly. YAHUAH HaMashiach, son of the living God. Hair like Basquiat, divine toast and wine from his soul. No private stop, his death was the cause of our transgression. Church put us on, but something off about that man complexion. I had to let go of the scholars and do some introspection. Truth trumps the devil's gospel and causes insurrection. Don't make us violent, that's the image of a sodomite killer. Don't keep us silent, ain't when it's tribe to identify with them. So you watch them, Caesarea, boy. Gia, be a pure demon, get behind me, devil, like the Messiah addressing Peter. Yah's glory gon' fall in Lebanon upon the cedars. They turn Yasharel into thugs and divas. Gave us male idols to worship with feminine features. A spiritual degree surpass a collegiate. The lion gon' arrive with unlimited ether and put Zion on his back, Jehoshaphat season. Yeah, everything gon' crash, everything gon' crash. 400 plus years, we finally free at last. I did enough years sober, it's time for me to spaz. Drunk in the spirit, only ice left in my glass. Don't put no glory on my name, it ain't no fame. I'm trying to collect, forget my story, I did my thing. But without the king, it ain't no unleft. Baptized by fire, we the Kadesh. Sitting in flames ever since he left. If he the tree, I'm in the nest. Put me a check, know I'm blessed. I confess when I make a mess. Wearing that word around my neck. We here to serve, we the elect. Only thing I'm smoking is this flesh.
To the cause. Dealing with the condition itself is not enough. And it is because of our effort toward getting straight to the root that people oftentimes think we are dealing in hate.
I give honor to HaMashiach, son of the Most High, the living word of the Father who is one with the Father at his right hand, close by. No love for that wicked graven image that is seared in our minds by the powers that be. Some of y'all close your eyes to pray, and when you do, that's who you see. Thou shalt not have no other gods. Shape nothing from the earth or from heaven or the sea. That's idol worship, and that's on purpose. Beloved, please allow the truth to set you free.
Welcome, 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 everybody. Shabbat Shalom. We made it. You know what I'm saying? We moved on up. We are, you know, we are here. We made it. You know, this is our time. This is our season. This is us you know, Black people, we finally then came out the struggle. You know, we got the opportunity now to achieve great results. I'm super excited about it, you know, but the question I ask is, why do you call yourself Black? You know, why do you identify with being Black? And we got all our different reasons. Some of us do it because we know the truth. Many of us do it because, you know, it's a custom. It's what we were brought under. But what is the, where did the origin of the word Black come from? You know, and why do we identify with that? So we're going to look at some biblical truths tonight about the word, the category, the identity of Black, where it came from, and, you know, what's really going on with this title. You know, one of the shows I used to watch growing up was The Jeffersons. And, you know, that intro that I just played, it was, you know, it was encouraging and inspiring because, you know, it was at a time right after the civil rights era where, you know, you had Jefferson and George and Jefferson, George Jefferson and Weezy, who came out and out the hood, you know, they came out of the struggle, the hard times, and they moved up to Manhattan on the east side, you know, where they had a successful dry cleaning business. And if you watch the show, I'm sure you remember a lot of the jokes that, you know, Mr. Jefferson used to share and how he would make fun of people and, you know, keep the show real lively. And for a lot of people, it was an inspiration at that time because of, you know, the different type of struggles and setbacks that people had endured, particularly coming through the civil rights era. And I hope you guys can see this here. Let me increase it a little bit. Not too worried about my picture. But, you know, it was during the time, you know, the civil rights era was from the 1940s to the 1960s. And if you can look at these pictures here, you can see, you know, it was the, you know, their fight against the KKK, you know, the, you couldn't go to certain places. And we had prominent people like Martin Luther King who got involved in order to try to help solve these issues of how, you know, people were being lynched or burned or whatever the case may be, these riots and fights, you know, white only signs. And we were really trying to, our parents or grandparents and great grandparents was trying to fight against the oppression against us as Black people. Because at the end of the day, when you look at the civil rights era and what they were asking for, with Martin Luther King and Malcolm X and a lot of these leaders that were asking for, was just some equality. You know, can we get treated the same way? Can we have the same type of life that you guys have without all the discrimination? And this brought, you know, a lot of tension in the United States of America, and, you know, throughout the world. You know, America has always been, even to this day, kind of the big show. Everybody's watching this country. What we're going to do next, how we've overcome different situations. You know, we know that basically when we look at the, the 2020 event, you know, many countries decided to respond to what happened in 2020 based on what we did as a country, right? So, that's why shows that came out afterward was even more inspirational. You know, The Cosby Show, Living Color, a different world. You know, these shows were, you know, motivating and inspiring to us because we saw what we, you know, projected, what we thought is projected to be how Black people act. You know, they're the Bill Cosby, you know, you had a doctor who was taking care of his family. They had a nice home. They ran into issues and struggles like everybody else. You know, and it wasn't, they didn't have any like strange problems. They dealt with, you know, maybe somebody hanging out with the wrong friends or, you know, people getting into different type of conflicts. Somebody needed to, you know, I remember an episode where the older daughter had to move back in because, you know, some issues with her husband as far as trying to get a job and keep their family life going. So, you know, it was stuff that was relatable. And when we see them hit the big screen, we're like, okay, you know, that's us. That's a reflection of me. You know, we all grew up in different situations. You know, some of us probably had more of like a single parent home. We only had the mom raising us, or we only had the dad raising us, or, you know, we had both parents, but they didn't get along. So, you know, you watched a lot of this stuff in TV on the big screen, and you're like, you know, that's us. We're coming up. We're doing this thing, you know. And, you know, I personally love TGI Friday. I couldn't wait to get home from school to come watch Family Matters or The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. So I could, you know, get into these shows and get my laugh on and see how they act and watch these characters, because it was attracting to us. You know, it was we were, you know, I didn't grow up with a silver spoon. I had a lot of issues, and a lot of these TV shows were relatable to me, you know. But then I watched the show, you know, Good Times, and I loved the show. It was a great show that, you know, even to this day, my kids watch the show. And, you know, when you look at the episode, you know, I was raised by a father to be a father. So when I watched it, and I think it was the third season where the father ended up dying in a car accident and no longer was on the show. And I thought, you know, that was a person I was really looking for, because I always wanted to be a father myself as a kid growing up, you know, and just even older in life. And you look at these shows and you see how they behave and how they respond, and you're thinking, man, is, you know, why'd they get rid of the guy? Because obviously, you know, they portrayed him as one that died in a car accident, but he actually didn't. So it wasn't until later on that I found out that, you know, John Amos, who played James Evans Jr. or Senior from Good Times, he was there for 2 years from 74 to 76, that he actually was having conflict with the writers of the TV show. And in 2017, he had an interview and he made a statement of why what he expressed to them and what they didn't agree with. And he told them, he said that that just doesn't happen in the community, that we don't think that way. We don't act that way. We don't let our children do that. You know, he was expressing how he believes, or how he experienced maybe in his family, or things he's seen that is a reflection of who we are as a Black people. And it wasn't being properly portrayed throughout the episodes that he was a part of. And eventually it turned out to cause him to lose his position there. He got dismissed in the third season. Of course, again, they play that role where he died in a car accident. So, you know, Hollywood wasn't really what we thought it was. I would say, in a sense, that you thought when you looked, you saw people coming up, you thought they were making it, you know, they were Black and they were coming out of the hood, they're on TV, but there was a lot of issues. And it wasn't just Hollywood. You know, there's actually an article that I read not too long ago, a recent article that talked about how, not in Hollywood as well, about the loss of $10 billion every year due to a lack of diversity. And the writer said that by ignoring the systematic racial inequalities that plague the film and TV business, Hollywood is leaving $10 billion annually on the table. $10 billion annually, they leave it on the table. When you think, you know, I know right now, I'm sure you guys probably watch the news, Hollywood, there's a big strike going on. They won't pay as they should. They want more money. And a big solve to that would be that $10 million they're throwing away. You think, why would Hollywood do that? You know, if they're in a need for money, you know, and it seems like they're all about making money, you know, because you got to pay those actors, especially the big time stars, some significant money every year. So, you know, you look at it, you think, well, if they can easily just put people on TV or in movies to help solve their issues and create more money, why wouldn't they do that? Because the truth is, it's not really about money. You know, it's a lot deeper than that. And we'll talk about that as we go on. And I also found an article on CNN that talked about how, you know, there looks to be a health crisis, you know, a shortage, because only 5.7% of the doctors are Black. And they're saying there, it's a warning of a shortage of public health, you know, that may harm public health because we don't have enough people that are Black in there. So is the public health issue because we don't have enough doctors, or is the public health issue because we don't have enough Black doctors, right? So I read into the article, and overall, they're basically saying that you need more people to be doctors, but discriminating against the people the world called Black creates that deficit, which ultimately creates the harm that we are looking at from a public health crisis, right? So even when you go into the White House in 2021, Joe Biden signed an executive order for diversity, equity, inclusion, and accessibility in the federal workplace. And I work for the federal government, 15 years, uniformed service, civil service, and I can tell you for sure, there is definitely a disproportion of people the world called Black in the government as a whole, as well as in specific roles. You know, that's just, it is what it is. I'm not making nothing up. I've seen it myself in different agencies. So I know the truth about what's going on. So This executive order is 13985, which is advancing racial equity and support of underserved communities throughout the federal government. Ultimately, it starts off, you get into the order, it talks about how you need basically more people in the world called Black to have opportunities working in the largest workforce in America, which is the government. Okay, so that's the complaint, that's the issue, that's what they're talking about, that's why this, that's what they said from the, in the beginning in order to sign this bill. But, you know, if you read down into it, it starts talking about the LGBTQ, I think that's what you call it, and, you know, different other agendas they want to push, all under the umbrella of, you know, equity, equality, civil rights, racial justice, whatever the case may be. But the big driving factor was Black people aren't getting the opportunity. That's what they're, that's what they push with this policy here, right? So we're going to talk about the biblical truth, the truth about race, right? The what the Bible says about race, from the biblical perspective, not the world's perspective, not the people who claim to be his leaders, but from those who wrote the scriptures, who are who had the prophecies, who knew the word. So we're going to get into that, but we're going to do a little bit of history. We're going to jog through some history over the recent centuries, in order to build the foundation to understand exactly how race and, you know, the title of Black plays a significant part in why you call yourself Black. You know, a lot of us don't know. I didn't know growing up. You know, I was called Black, hang out with Black kids, Black family members. When I finally got to fill out my military documents to join the service, I checked, you know, African-American Black. I've done that before in different ways. So, you know, that is something we're going to discuss tonight. So first thing we have to do is we have to understand and agree with two facts, right? Two biblical facts. It's the only way to actually understand what we're getting ready to talk about tonight. And this is, again, we're talking about the biblical understanding, not the world's understanding, right? The world's understanding is all kind of different, you know, theories, and, you know, you got philosophers and scholars, but when it comes to what the Bible says, there's two facts you have to actually accept, right? The first thing is the Most High does not change. That's number one, right? The Bible makes it clear. If you follow the word from Genesis to Revelation, you will see a firm consistency in how the Most High, the God of heaven, YAHUAH, operates. He has not changed. Doctrine has changed. People's perspective about the Bible has changed. Their feelings change. You know, society changes. The social construct of the Bible have changed, but the word itself has remained the same. Even with the different type of translations or manipulations of scripture, the consistency of the Most High has remained the same. This is why in chapter 3, verse 6, he says, "For I am YAHUAH, I do not change, therefore you are not consumed, O sons of Jacob. And this is when Malachi is given a prophecy given to him by the Most High about the people calling them to repent, to turn from their sins. And he's explaining that they need to obviously do away with these ways that they shouldn't and come back to me. Now, if you read Malachi, you go to chapter 3, verse 8. This is the one of the famous scriptures where they say, you know, if a man robs God. It's talking about, you know, tithe and offering. He says, "How have you robbed me? Should a man rob God? How have you robbed me?" And he, you know, this is when the preacher gives this statement in order to compel you to pull out your checkbook and write a check so that you can put money into his house and not the Most High storehouse. All right. That's why they have to come up with this scripture. Right. This is a prominent one. But there's much more to Malachi chapter 3 than will a man rob God when it comes to tithe. All right. Yep. You are supposed to pay tithe. But at the same time, it's for the storehouse and not the preacher's house, right? I'm talking about those that we all can probably pull up right now who are multimillionaires that didn't miss a beat when the world shut down and ain't missing a single meal during this economy chaos that we're seeing, right? So he has always remained the same since day one. He has not changed. The promises that he made, the word that he's given to Abraham, He made those promises to stay in the same. We live in the day and age where the Christianity has did away with, for the most part, the Old Testament, the Torah. They only talk about we're all God's children and all these different things. And it's just, you know, end of the day, it's a twisting of scripture. And I'm going to show you how Christianity was, it's an influence and things that have occurred to give you guys some truth. All right. So second thing we have to look at is the Most High cannot lie. All right. He cannot lie. I know I've talked to a lot of people and they often tell me, you know what, you know, there's some contradictory statements in the scriptures and the Most High, you know, or the God or God or Lord or, you know, the different names that people give him. They say, well, you know, there's things that don't add up. There's written by man and all these different excuses basically they use to not agree with the entire word or deny it altogether. Say it's just a book of myths, but he hasn't lied. He's fulfilled everything he said in the season in which he said it will happen. He's fulfilling promises as we speak. All right. And Numbers chapter 23, verse 19, it says, YAHUAH is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. Has he said, and he will he not do? Or has he spoken and will he not make it good? All right. He is going to do everything he said. He's done it time and time again. We have to understand that he has a name to uphold. He has a reputation to keep. And everything he does, he doesn't need to repent for like us, because it's not wrong. He does what is right all the time. We may not agree. We may not like it. We may not believe it. But if you don't believe the word to be true and he can't lie, then you're going to struggle with this training that we're doing or this study that we're going through right now. All right. So we're going to move on to, he cannot lie. That's the truth, right? Pinocchio right there. You know, folks, we all lie. We all said stuff we had no business saying, but the Most High doesn't do that, right? All right, so there is history, and then there is his story, all right? The origin of race and the rise of enlightenment and the black, right? The black people, black culture, black nation, black mama, black daddy, black whatever you want to call it, the rise of the enlightenment, right? Interestingly enough, they both came together. We're going to see that as we go along. But know this, there are the stories that are written for the masses, and there are stories that is written for the few. What I mean by that is most people don't take the time to study. Most people don't take the time to get into the word and know the truth. And go through what they have in front of them. The Bible itself is, at the end of the day, it's all the real information you need, right? There are books out there, people explain stuff. You have these, like I'm doing right now, perfect example. I'm giving training, we're doing the study, we're going through the word, but the Spirit of the Most High God was sent because of the constant great manipulation and deception that takes place in the world. And the whole purpose is so that we can navigate the word. You know, we have to have the discipline, first and foremost. You have to want to sit down and read the Bible, study the word, because the truths are in there. And you can look in the word and let the Spirit of truth lead you, and you can take that word and apply it to the things of this world today and know truth. You know, I told someone the other day, I said, you know, I did a video not too long ago, or actually last week, it was a series on, you know, what's happening with Esau now, prophecies being fulfilled. And a lot of people got upset because, you know, unfortunately, many of us have been blinded by this ideology of race. So when you talk about Esau being a European, people get offended. When you talk about black people being the chosen people, they get offended. But if you took away color, and there was nothing in the Bible that spoke of skin color or tone, and if you looked at the characteristics of the Edomites, and you looked at the characteristics of the house of Yashareel, the Israelites, you will see exactly who they are. You can compare the characteristics, their behavior, over a period of time, over centuries, over, and the prophecies has been spoken, and you can see them without seeing color, right? But, you know, it comes down to denial of self, of flesh. So, race category, you've probably all seen this before. You went to fill out a job, you went to, you know, whatever it is, the application for college, and they ask you, what is your race or your ethnicity, right? And then you got Asian, Native Hawaiian, Black, African-American, white, Hispanic, right? All these different things. And now more than ever, you're going to find where it says other, right? You can write in what you want to be these days. You can choose whatever your race is. You know, and we've seen this plenty of times before. There's a lot of actors now, their kids are coming out saying they're not white, they're black, you know, black is a thing. It's not a whatever, you know, so just a lot of nonsense. But end of the day, this is what we've all probably seen. And it's all for reasons by design. All right. So here's something quite interesting that I found on Webster Dictionary. Right. And it talks about the history and the meaning of ethnicity. All right. And this highlighted part area, I'm going to read this right here and let you hear some truths. All right. It says when seen on an fillable form, ethnicity refers to a 20th century construct that is based on the objective ethnic, which dates much earlier and was originally used to describe Gentiles or nations not converted to Christianity, similar to the objectives heathen or pagan. Ethnic enters Middle English via late Latin ethnics, if I'm saying that correctly, and ultimately derives from the Greek ethnicals, meaning national or Gentile, and is related to ethnos, nations or people. Right now, the reason why I highlighted this and I thought this was quite interesting was that it said that people that are described as Gentiles or nations not converted to Christianity. All right. Again, go back. We have to, you know, the Bible tells us what a nation of Gentile is. It doesn't say a person that's not converted to Christianity. Okay. That's not what the scripture says. You're going to see more of this as we continue to go on. All right. Now, colonialism. It's an important piece here to the understanding of race category, right? According to Smedley and Marx, the European concept of race, along with many of the ideas now associated with the term, rose at the time of scientific revolution, which introduced and privileged the study of natural kinds and the age of European imperialism and colonization, which established political relations between Europeans and peoples with distinct culture and political traditions. All right, I'll skip down to the second. I gotta get this logo out of the way here. All right, skip down to the bottom part here. You highlight it, says the rise of the Atlantic slave trade, which gradually displaced an earlier trade in slaves from throughout the world, created a further incentive to categorize human groups in order to justify the subordination of African slaves. All right, so they're telling you the understanding colonialism, right? When they colonized the world, they're basically telling you that the reason they had this, the reason they had to create these categories was to ensure that they categorized groups to keep subordination. They wanted to make sure that the slaves remained below them. All right, that was the purpose. That was the overall goal of creating these categories. All right, so who is the ultimate father of creating race? Right, it's a guy by the name of Johann Friedrich Blumenbach. All right, he was a German physician, naturalist, sociologist, anthropologist, and pseudoscientist, right? Interesting fact is that his teachings is comparative in comparative autonomy were applied to his classification of human race, of which he claimed, right? He claimed, remember his story, there were five races, all right? Caucasian, Mongolian, Malayan, Ethiopian, and American, right? So American, according to this gentleman, is a race, right? That's what he thought or believed or whatever his perspectives were, right? And what's interesting was that Blumenbach peers considered him to be one of the greatest theorists of his day. And he was a mentor or influence of many of the next generation of German biologists, including Alexander von Humboldt. That is an interesting character that we're going to talk about now, all right? He was also a German polymath, geographer, naturalist, explorer, and prominent romantic philosophy in science, all right? So what's interesting about this gentleman was that There is a lot more details about what he did, but he had the opportunity to travel all throughout the world as a liaison, if you will, to connect with a lot of world leaders and set some standards and some tones. And because he got the green light to meet with different world leaders, different country leaders during his time, and his influence and understanding of things, he was accepted into what was called the Weimar Classics, whose practitioners established a new humanism for synthesis in the ideas of romanticism, classicism, and the Age of Enlightenment. All right, Age of Enlightenment is an important piece to why we live in this Black ideology, right? Which happened during the 17th and the 18th century. All right, this is when they blew up. They were most noticed and thought about and recorded in history. What's also interesting is that many scientists and thinkers who contributed to the Enlightenment were Christians, also called Puritans, right? Puritans are the first supposed Christians that came to America when the Atlantic slave trade took place to colonize this land, okay? Now, we're going to hit through some more characters. We're going to do a little jogging through history. We're not going to get to, and I know, you know, a lot of us might have a little issue with jogging through history because we're so used to the instant stuff, but we got to get to these. We got to lay this foundation so we'll know where we're headed. All right. So let's talk a little bit about the Age of Enlightenment. Again, 17th to the 18th centuries, the idea of enlightenment, which emphasizes science and reasoning over faith and superstition, strongly influenced the American colonies in the 18th century, right? These were supposed to be the great thinkers of the world. These were the great minds that came together here in the U.S. of A., right? And to be able to bring a different thought to how the world, how people, how everything happens through science and reason, okay? Interestingly enough, the Freemasons were members of a fraternal society that advocated Enlightenment principles of inquiry and tolerance, right? We're going to look a little bit into the Freemasons, one of the most well-knit and throughout the world entities, all right? Freemasons, all right? They teach, they teach and practice a fraternal men-only order of free and acceptant Masons. The world's largest secret society. You know, I knew a gentleman who told me one day, he said, you know, we're not a secret society. We're just a society that has secrets. And I was like, okay, that's whatever. You know, people try to spin you with stuff, but quite interesting that he said that. All right. So the biggest thing was that they spread by the advancement of the British Empire, right? Freemasons. You may know some out there. You've probably seen this symbol, but they started through the British Empire, and it was during a time that it was well before the time that any slave was free per the, the Emancipation Proclamation, right? The first Freemason Lodge originated in London coffee houses in the 17th century, okay? Moving on. So, interestingly enough, I'm probably going to say that a lot, but that's okay. Benjamin Franklin, a foremost founding father of America, right? Benjamin, Big Ben on the money, right? History tells us that one prominent member, Benjamin Franklin, stands as a embodiment of the Enlightenment in British America. He was at the top of the food chain. He represented the Enlightenment era, and he was also a Freemason, okay? He was part of the He was part of the St. John's Lodge in 1732. Again, this is before America even signed its Declaration of Independence. And, you know, he was a part of the establishment of this country. And it's so interesting because people always say, oh, this country was founded on Christian people who loved the Lord and they loved the Bible. And, well, you know, we're going to look at how the Freemasons align with the Bible. All right. If you don't already know. But again, you know, he became a Grand Master in 1734. So 2 years after he was involved in writing the bylaws or drafting the bylaws, he also became a Grand Master. So he was part of a lot of the foundation of the Freemason organization. here in America, as well as established in this country. All right, so let's move on. Prince Hall, free slave. If you know anything about Freemasons, he was the first Black Freemason to ever join, and he joined as a free slave, right? He was an American abolitionist and a leader in the free Black community in Boston. Having been rejected by the colonial American Freemasons, Hall and 14 others sought and were initiated into Masonry through Lodge number 441, the Grand Lodge of Ireland, on March 6, 1775. So it was right at the time the Declaration of Independence was signed, about 8 months later, he was in Ireland. 8 months before, excuse me, he was in Ireland, okay, signing away his ability to join a Grand Lodge as a Freemason, okay? Down at the bottom of here, I got Hall and other freedmen founded African Lodge number one, and he was elected master, right? He was the head guy that was elected, right? So moving on. Charles Cordones Poindexter, right? Graduated Ohio State University, went on to Cornell University, where he established the Alpha Phi Alpha Society. This society became Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity, established on December 4th, 1906. All right, so we jumped ahead a little bit in the timeline here. And it says Alpha Phi Alpha is the first Black intercollegiate having more than one college chapter fraternity, right? So they're in more than one place, not just at a certain university, right? So move along. We're going to get to Charles H. Wesley, right? African-American historian, educator, minister, and author. This gentleman wrote over 15 books about African-American history and political science. He was also known as executive of the Sigma Phi Pi, the Boulé, the first of the all-Black Greek letter organizations, right? The BGLO. So I'm gonna take a little pause here, and I want you to ask yourself, why would someone join or be a part of Greek lettering organization, has its roots in Greek, when the Messiah was Hebrew, right? So just keep that in your mind as we move along. What's so interesting also is that Wesley was a Prince Hall Freemason, a Sovereign Grand Inspector General, 33 degree, right? He was at the top, or at least close to the top, one of the top. And let's see here, what else? Of the United Supreme Council, Southern Jurisdiction, Prince Hall, a member of the Old Fellas, the Elks, and many other fraternal organizations. So this brother was involved in all of it. He had his hands and feet in every aspect of organizations that were started by the Europeans. Okay. It says Wesley was an active member of Alpha Phi Alpha, the first intercollegiate Greek letter fraternity created by and for African Americans, right? So we can move on. The Boulé, right? The Black Boulé, Sigma Pi Phi, right? This organization was founded in 1904, right? It's the oldest fraternity for Black Americans, right? This is outside of the Freemasons Lodge, but you know, there's connections obviously there, because they intertwine. You can't, you know, you join one group, you're typically going to be a part of another, right? So this fraternity quickly established chapters referred to as member Boulés in Chicago, Illinois, and then Baltimore, Maryland. The founders included two doctors, a dentist and a pharmacist, right? Two doctors, a dentist and a pharmacist. It's interesting because, you know, we look at Revelation, it talks about what sorcery is. In Revelations, it says sorcery. In Greek, the word sorcery is pharmateka. In English, it's pharmaceuticals, right? And the scripture tells us those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of heaven, right? So, but they joined that organization, right? And these were some very prominent gentlemen in the time that they were a part of this establishment. They weren't just any Joes. These guys are very influential in the Black communities. All right, so we move along to the Divine Nine. All right, these are the nine fraternity and sorority organizations that ultimately came out of the Black Boulé, right? They were established. The first one was the Alpha Alpha, as I said, and these continue to come along the way. And it tells us here that the National Pan-Hellenic Council, the NPHC, is the collaborative umbrella control or council composed of historically African-American fraternities and sororities, also referred to as the BGLO, right? The Black Greek Letter Organizations, right? The NPHC was founded as a permanent organization May 10th, 1930, on the campus of Howard University in Washington, D.C., and Matthew W. Bullock as the active chairman, and Beatrix Scott, the vice chairman. And so that's where we're at. They were established. These organizations, you've probably seen them, they're at every Black university or HBC, historically Black college, college and universities, and very instrumental, right? What they do, there's a lot of hazing, if you will, a lot of people doing things that aren't biblical. They're associating with different type of acts that are clearly forbidden in scripture, and we don't need to get into all that. This is not that kind of training. We're not going to expose the Divine Nine or the Black Boulé. We're going through a history timeline so that you can see the connections to understand why you call yourself Black and how they tie into the Age of Enlightenment. Okay. The origin of the Black Church, right? This is something that a lot of us don't know how it started. I was, I had a lot of people don't want to hear about the Sabbath day being Saturday and not Sunday, because as far back as, great grandma went to church, it was always Sunday. But the scriptures is clear, and when the Most High gave Moses the instructions for the Sabbath, the day, the time, what they should do, all that was already outlined. But again, we're going to look at some interesting stuff here. So the Black Church started forming in the 1800s, all right? So the Black Church, also known as Black Christianity or African-American Christianity, is the faith or the body of Christian denominations and congregations in the United States that minister predominantly to African Americans, as well as collective traditions and members. The term Black Church also refers to individual congregations, right? I grew up in a Black church, so I know what they mean by going to a Black church. Also, as I became a minister along the years, I got involved in other denominations, and they were predominantly of what the world called white, right? So that was one of the, you knew you was at a white church or Black church, and I'm gonna use these terminologies, dude. I don't follow the constructs in that aspect, but you got to use the terminology because that's relatable to people to understand, so they know what I'm talking about. But there's the race and all that. It's a different type of understanding. So let's see here. So predominantly Protestant denominations such as African Methodist Episcopal Church, AME. We all know that, right? The Church of God in Christ, COGIC. And then you got the National Baptist Convention, including Black Catholic churches, right? So all this started to come out of the 1800s. So it was about 15 or so years after America became quote-unquote independent, the Declaration of Independence, 4th of July. We started having this cool Black rise of us running our own churches, doing our thing. All right, so we're going to move on here, and we're going to look at some interesting facts about how they were actually established. All right, so you got John Wesley in 17th century. He founded the Methodist Episcopal Church, right? That was his organization. And from that, Richard Allen in 1816 formed the African American Episcopal Church, right? And the purpose was he wanted to create his own, and there was the segregation. You couldn't do what you want to do. You couldn't have control. There were actually, they didn't even allow for a significant amount of time for ministers to preach or teach or even have a simple Bible study if you didn't have a white pastor present, right? They didn't allow that. You had to have them oversee the whole program. So he broke off and created his own, said free, right here it says, freed slave free slave and accepted Methodist Episcopal Church. So he was accepted into John Wesley's church. This is how he learned the Methodist ideology, right? Because John Wesley taught him, right? And he's named after, he was named, there's a lodge 30 actually named after Richard Allen, right? The guy who started the Methodist organization for Black people. They actually named a lodge for him in Massachusetts. Right, then you get over to Roger Williams in 1715, in the 17th century, founder of the First Baptist Church. Right, he's the head dude. He made the Baptist thing happen. And what's, you know, some interesting facts we're going to show you here in a second. But out of his church, you had William H. McAlpine, and about 150 additional Black Baptist pastors. They were tired of the segregation, the racism, all the different things that came along. So they decided to start their own National Baptist Convention Incorporated. Right? But again, where did they learn Baptist ideology from? The same place from Roger Williams, just as Richard Allen learned the Methodist ideology from John Wesley. Then the Kojic Church of God in Christ, that's established in 1897. And the reason being because there was some group of Black folks like Charles Prince Jones and Charles Harrison Mason who got booted out of the church. They got booted out of the Baptist Convention, the National Baptist Convention. So they went out and started their own, right? There's various reasons. They didn't like the doctrine. They couldn't get along, whatever the case may be. So they went out and started their own organization. And, you know, First Baptist Church is the largest denomination in the world. Then you got the Kojic, and then you also have Methodists that come behind that. So, but something interesting about this guy here named Roger Williams, you know, people love their Baptist stuff. They love their Baptist church. They love their denomination, you know, and they're hardcore to the T about it. They'll fight the Calvinists, the John Calvin folks, and they'll fight all other kind of stuff. But the truth is, Roger Williams was a very interesting character based on Lodge, what was written in about him in Lodge 32, Freemason Lodge, right? They were actually trying to figure out how to name the lodge. And they said they argued, however, that Roger Williams possessed the traits of character and vow and views of human duty towards God and man quite in accord with the general principles of Freemasonry. Right. It was then decided that the name of Roger Williams should be adopted as the designation of the lodge. So why would the lodge, if there was a clear distinction between Roger Williams and his faith as a Baptist and the actions of Freemason, which are not the same. Right. People like to try to connect the two. They're not. When I'm talking about biblical truths, not so much denomination, but biblical truths, they are complete distinct ways between the two. Okay, so you're not going to name somebody after your organization that is known for its secrecy and its eliteness and how it's been involved in the world for a long time, who doesn't agree with what you believe, right? It just makes basic sense. You don't even need to have no spiritual deep understanding of that. All right, so we're going to move on a little bit. What did the Baptist Church think about, all right, the Southern Baptist Convention? What do they think about Freemasonry? You know, I've talked to Baptists before. They go, oh, no, there's no way we're going to accept something like that. But here's what they told him in 1992. This is the recommendation they gave about Freemasonry, right? It says, in light of the fact of many tenets and teachings of Freemasonry are not compatible with Christianity and the Southern Baptist doctrine, while others are compatible with Christianity and Southern Baptist doctrine, we therefore recommend that consistent with our denomination's deep convictions regarding the priesthood of the believer and the autonomy of the church, members in the Masonic order, right, be a matter of personal membership in the Masonic order be a matter of personal conscience, right? Highlighted here in yellow, so interesting. Let me blow this up here. It says, therefore, we exhort Southern Baptists to prayerfully and carefully evaluate Freemasonry in light of the lordship of Christ, the teachings of the scriptures, and the findings of this report as led by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God. Now, I think that's quite interesting that they said, you guys basically pray about it, right? Just pray about what you think the Freemason, joining a Freemason or being part of it as a member of the Baptist Church. But what does the Bible say? What does the scripture say? Ephesians chapter 5, verse 11 says, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. There's a lot of dark stuff the Freemasons do. All right. There's a lot, period. All this good that I've met a few. I've been these different lodges and stuff. I've been invited to these organizations. People told me some things that are part of them. They show me their rings and all this good stuff. And I can tell you, it doesn't align with the word. Right? What's secretive? Why do you need to keep the gospel if that's what they do? If they're truly about righteousness, why do you need to keep it so secret from society? That's just a dead giveaway right there. Right? But instead of actually casting down the lies and telling their members not to live according to such ways, they tell them to basically pray about it, right? And let the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, lead you. That's not sound teaching. The Apostle Paul said, if anybody brings another doctrine to you, that person is cursed. Let that person be cursed. If they preach another gospel, he said, if me or even an angel preach another gospel, he said, forget about that person. All right. Walk away from them. Don't even entertain that. All right. So we're going to look at the Freemason tree of influence. All right. How are they involved in churches, the world? All right. I put together a little diagram here, and it shouldn't be too challenging to look at, but you know, it can be a little bit. Let me get this logo off of here. It's like trying to chase a fly. All right. So first and foremost, I've put in here that the Enlightenment group consisted of ministers, reverends, Puritans, Christians, physicians, naturalists, physiologists, anthropologists, theorists, scholars, anthropologists, or philanthropists, and pseudoscientists. All right. This is what the Enlightenment group consists of. So you had your Christians or Puritans a part of this group. So long before there was a First Baptist church, long before there was a Methodist organization or any church in itself as an organization in America, you already had this Enlightenment group of people called Puritans and Christians. So before the country was erected, all right? The Freemasons and the Enlightenment group share the same views and practices. They worked in the same type of mindset. They were all connected, all right? The Freemasons were part of were presidents and politicians. They were involved in establishing the country from day one. We saw that with Benjamin Franklin, all right? Freemasons created or led to the creation of Prince Hall Freemasonry in 1706. And from the Hall Masons, the Prince Hall Freemasons, they recruited from the Black Church. The reason why you know this is because you didn't get into Prince Hall Freemason unless you were Black. And you hadn't already established universities and colleges like that for Black people. So the only place to recruit them from were the organizations that they gathered in, where they talked and communicated, made plans, fellowship, whatever the case may be. That's where their recruitment started, right? And then you get the Boulé, the Black Boulé, Sigma Pi Phi, started in May 15, 1904. They recruited not only from the Black Church, but they were part of the establishment of the Divine Nine fraternities and sororities, and they recruited from them. You basically can't be a Black Boulé unless you come out one of these organizations, these fraternities or sororities, right? That was intentional so that you can come through the education, the doctrine, the training that is suitable for their organization. You just can't walk in there some Joe off the street. You had to already be conditioned to live according to how they operate. So if you look at it, there is a net that the Freemasons had complete involvement in and established in the ideology of Black churches. You have Black sorority groups. You had the Black Prince Hall Freemason, the Black Boulé, right? But it all came from the Enlightenment group. Right, these were all people, either they were Freemason or Enlightenment, and this spilled over into the establishment of what we call these Black organizations that a lot of us have heard of or maybe even are a part of, all right? So let's move on here. All right, there's a couple of notable Black Freemasons. You got Sugar Ray Leonard here to the left. You got Shaquille O'Neal. You got Richard Pryor, Barack Obama. You know, there's a lot of denying that he is, but he's done enough hand signals. If you know how Freemasons operate on the public and stuff that's been exposed in books by guys who came up missing for exposing stuff, you know that he's rocking that. He wouldn't be at that top if he wasn't rocking what they're rocking, right? Martin Luther King, Jesse Jackson, Jay-Z, and Al Sharpton, right? So you look at it, Freemasons are involved in every aspect the Black people are involved in: entertainment, politics, church, comedy, sports. They're all connected, right? There's so many more pictures I can put up here because, you know, as the time get on, people want to tell people they're part of organizations. Secrets don't stay secrets forever. You know, things come out, you know, people get exposed. But these are just some of the prominent people I want you to see to show you how well-knit, if for a long time, this organization has been in the quote-unquote Black community. All right? Why did they tell you that you were Black? All right? This is a question that you should ask yourself, because you didn't call yourself Black. You didn't identify that, you know what, I'm a Black person. Right? You didn't wake up one morning and say, this ideology was, again, established while people the world called Black were in slavery. Right? They were in chains. They weren't walking around saying, I'm Black. Right? So here is the narrative from mainstream media. Right? I highlighted some pieces in here. It's very interesting. And this is from Wikipedia. Wikipedia, you know, I don't make it 100% trusted source. When I go to Wikipedia, I read what's in there and I go through different books and articles and websites where these information should be regarding the particular organizations or history to help confirm. And of course, a lot of this stuff is factual when they put it out there. The reason why is because when you tie things together, most people don't tie the truths together and they know that, so it's not worth hiding. At the same time, it also helps perpetuate the narrative that helps people follow an agenda that, again, is hidden in plain sight, all right? So this is the narrative says that African-Americans are the descendants from Africa who were forced into slavery after they were captured during the American wars, the African wars and riots, right? So when they're saying that when Africa had wars and riots, African-Americans somehow were captured and taken into slavery by, you know, again, we'll read on. It says they were captured and brought to America as part of the Atlantic slave trade, right? African-Americans are descendants from various ethnic groups, mostly of the ethnic group that lived in Western and Central Africa, including Sahel, right? I might mess up some of these names. You know, I'm working on my communicating without butchering names. All right. A smaller number of African-Americans were descendants from ethnic groups who lived in Eastern and Southern, Southeastern Africa. The major ethnic groups that the enslaved Africans belonged to included the Bukongo, the Logbo, the Mende, the Wolof, Akan, Fon, and the Yubra. Oh, and the Mankua. I think I said that right. among many others. Although the different groups varied in customs, religion, theologies, and languages, what they had in common was a way of life. So they were relatable to each other. They practiced, for the most part, a lot of the same way, right? Originally, the majority of the future slaves came from villages and societies. However, once they were sent to the Americans and enslaved the different people of And these different people had European standards and beliefs forced upon them, causing them to do away with tribal differences and forged a new history and culture that was was a creolization of their common past, present, and European culture. So it says that they had ways forced upon them. They were actually made to believe and act a certain way that was never a part of their culture. All right. This is a very, very interesting statement here from Wikipedia, which is a very true statement, too. We know that if you did a little bit of history, you know that what people learned as believers, as slaves, when it comes to being a believer, was actually forced upon them. Why was that? We'll find that out here in a second. All right. So last part here, slaves who belong to the specific African ethnic groups were more sought after and became more dominant in numbers than slaves who belong to other African ethnic groups in certain regions of what later became the United States, right? Good information right there. Now, here's the truth. We've all heard about the narrative, the mainstream narrative, but here is the absolute truth, all right? Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 15 through 69. If you listen to anything that I've shared, verse 68, anything that I've shared when it comes to who are the chosen people, you know I reference Deuteronomy chapter 28 often because it is foundational to knowing who the people are. If you like to go, if you decide to go colorblind, you can see it. You don't need to, well, they were black. No, you can know who these people are through Acts. And I'm going to look at some, I'm going to read off some of the curses that were given to them that the Most High spoke about in Deuteronomy chapter 28 that identified the peculiar people of whom are his chosen people, right? Verse 15, it starts out and said, "It shall come to pass, if you do not obey my voice, the voice of the Adon, your Elohim, to observe carefully all his commandments and his statutes, which I command you today, that all these curses will come upon you and overtake you," right? And here's a few of them. You say, curse you shall be in the city, curse you shall be in the country, right? So you're going to be cursed wherever you go. Curse shall be your basket and your kneading bowl, right? Curse shall be the fruit of your body, your children, and the produce of your land, and the increase of your cattle, and the offspring of your flock. So everything they had from their children, cursed. Curse you shall be when you come in, curse you shall be when you go out. So everywhere you step, you're going to have problems. Skip down here to 32. It says, "Your sons and daughters shall be given to another people, and your eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all day long, and there shall be no strength in your hand." Right? I'm sure you all saw Color Purple. If you haven't, this is a clear indication what they're talking about. Color Purple. Right? He lost their kids and was longing to see them. Right, and that's just Hollywood's version of it, but it's stuff a whole lot worse than that. If you do a little more research in history, all right? Couple more curses here. We're gonna look at on the next page. It says, "The Elohim who is among you shall rise higher and higher above you, and you shall come down lower and lower." All right, Elohim, that means the foreigner, people that don't actually belong to that particular country. They're gonna move up, you're gonna go down. I don't know about you, but I've seen this in experiences tons of times before, right? People who technically don't belong in the country come in and get, boom, awesome benefits, rising up, get the wealth connect, and then you get the boot, right? 44, he shall lend to you and you shall not lend to him, and he shall be the head and you shall be the tail, right? The opposite. I know you probably went to church and the pastor was like, you the head and not the tail. He's declaring all that to you, making you say it and stand up and write it on your notepad and in your mirror and say it in the morning. But he's not telling you the truth of why, who, where, what, and why that was actually said and how it actually applies. So we're going to skip to verse 66. It says, "Your life shall hang in doubt before you. You shall fear day and night and have no assurance of life." Now, we can definitely see this in the Atlantic slave trade, right? You didn't know you was going to get tossed off the boat because you looked sick. You didn't know, how you were going to survive. If they're going to use you as an example to break down the rest of the strong men so they can follow the, procedures and whatever the case may be. So, but we can also apply that to today. Now, I worked in law enforcement in the federal government for quite some time, and I understand a lot of people get, black people got it free and all that kind of stuff. And discrimination and cops being killed by black people, there's truth to both sides of the story. However, I grew up in South Central LA, and for a lack of better term analogy, I was pulled over several times driving while black. No probable cause, wasn't speeding, wanted me out of my car, searched my car, had to deal with that several times, right? It was, you know, no violation whatsoever. And I wanted to be a police officer. I even became one and got pulled over. So I understand how this actually is living out to be true. People looking over their shoulders, wondering what's going to happen to them. And it's not just when it comes to law enforcement. So that's just the ideology they're using to press the agenda to keep people deceived, right? And I'm just going to skip down here to verse 68. It says, and the Adon will take you back into Egypt in ships, right? He will take you back into Egypt in ships. The purpose of that was to be a slave, right? You're going back to Egypt. And that came out of Exodus with Moses. They went back, right? They went back into Egypt. And I did some history on that and a few other videos. But again, we're not going to go too deep into that because that's really not the point. But we're drawing parallels and connections here, so we'll know the truth, right? We're going to move on. Even though they went into exile in 605 BC, Daniel went into exile because of them being cursed, right? And every time the people of the Most High God disobeyed, they went into exile, that those who went into exile who were captured were those who survived that didn't succumb to the sword, plagues, or the famine. Right, these things happened to them because they didn't obey. However, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and a few others through different stories were the remnants of those who were favored. Right, they found favor in that Babylonian lifestyle that they had to endure because of the overall disobedience of the people. Right, the Most High, you know, he'll keep you, but sometimes your peoples would mess it up for you. But even if they mess it up, he'll still keep you. And I'm living proof of that. Right. So moving on here. A lot of times people look at Babylon when they fell in 70 AD and they say, this is it. You know, prophecy is fulfilled. And I just brought this up here to just to really tell you guys, there's another temple that's going to be built, and it's going to be the final one. It's going to be specifically for the Antichrist, this man of sin, the son of perdition, right? And we're going to see more significant prophecies fulfilled when it comes to the truth and understanding who are the people the world called black and different race groups and stuff like that, right? So let's slide on a little bit. Question: if the Christianity taught to the slaves was true, why were they beat into accepting it? Right. That's an important question that came to my head here. Just the other day. I mean, it's a simple question, but it's an important question, because if what you're saying is true, if your faith is real and it comes from the Most High God and it comes from the Bible, right, the understanding of the Bible, the Christianity that they believe is true, then why would slaves have to be beat into it? This is historical fact. This is not something I've come up with. My wife's great grandmother was born into slavery, you know, and she talked about these things often. They had to submit through beating, right? If it was a true faith, then why do you have to do that, right? So the reason being, so that prophecy can be fulfilled, right? What was the prophecy? Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 64. Then the Adon will scatter you among all peoples from one end of the earth to the other, and there you shall serve other gods which neither you nor your fathers have known, wood and stone. There's a couple different understandings of the wood and stone that often is missed. One was that wood and stone is the ideology of a fake Messiah. Right, you go back to the time the Israelites, the house of YAHUAH came out of Egypt. They were in the wilderness and they made that golden calf, right? Serving a false god. That is the ways of the pagans, the Edomites, the heathens, right? They serve these gods erected by statues. The image of the Messiah is also that in a correlation with that, right? You have this guy hanging on the cross who's supposed to be the Messiah. Well, when you go through lineage, you go through history, you go through understanding, there's facts that you will find in the Bible, and as well as history, that dispels a lot of the ideology that was created by him hanging on the cross. And it was also when the Israelite, when the Yahash Yahshua was in Egypt, they built, they helped build that the entire nation, right? All of it. They helped erect the whole thing. That was a form of worship. They, and they also had to serve those gods. 400 years in slavery, you wasn't serving the God of the Most High. You, your kids died off. You know, your family, those people who first went in who knew the Most High God, they didn't learn that. They weren't allowed to teach that, right? Same thing that happened to the people who came to America. They were not allowed to teach of what they knew. They could not hold on to those beliefs. If they did, they were beat. And if they kept doing it, they were destroyed. Okay? So they had to, so that prophecy would be fulfilled. This is the reason why you had to be, your ancestors had to be beat into under, to accepting Christianity. Right? Now, here's some harsh truth. I started reading this book and there's some great details in there. It's like $16 on Amazon. I'm actually working on trying to put a reprint copy on my website, but how to make a Negro a Christian, right? And I don't recommend too many books because I'm not a book reader like that. I used to be when I was a, you know, motivational speaker. I used to read tons of books of how to, you know, inspire people and all that. But then I realized the only book that's really important is the scripture. However, in this teaching that we're doing today, and, you know, YAHUAH willing, continue to elaborate on later on, this book is very essential to understanding some historical facts about Christianity written by or established, these actual techniques and strategies that they use to make sure those who came out of the Atlantic slave trade would be converted into Christianity. And it wasn't, do you know Jesus? All right. It was none of that. It was, have you a personal relationship with the Lord? No, it was a completely different transformation because they not only wanted you to become a Christian, but they wanted the ideologies of what they believe to carry on for decades, all right, for centuries. They wanted you to have that, which most people follow today, all right? So if you get a chance, take a look at this book. Again, like I said, I don't recommend too many, but it's some good truths in here, historical facts. All right, so we're going to move along a little bit. And we're going to talk about it quickly. Joseph Smith, Arthur, who authored the Book of Mormon, which says another testament of Jesus Christ. And in 1830, it is thought to believe that he had this deep interaction with some type of spirit, angel, whatever, who told him these revelations he found these scrolls buried in the ground and didn't know how to read it. And the angel came along and showed him how to interpret everything, right? One of the things that he said in his writings was that black people are cursed with dark skin because of their disobedience, right? That's why they are dark. That's why we are dark, because, you know, we didn't obey. When you go back to Deuteronomy chapter 28 and you read all those curses, verse 15 all the way to 68, and you look at any other curses in scripture, you will find that that is not the case. There is no such thing as black being a curse, right? And then what's so interesting as well is this person here, Nephi, is not found in the Bible, right? And it says, however, I also put in here that the word Nephilim is found in the Bible two times. Genesis chapter 6 and Numbers chapter 13. And what's so interesting is that these are the identified as the giants or the falling angels that came here who helped create chaos in the world to the point where the Most High decided to save Noah and his family only and flood everybody else out. All right? So it's just some interesting facts about this. I just want to bring that out to see how deep, and again, 1830. So this is during the time, you know, well before, this is during this, you know, after America was being, when America is still being colonized, it's an independent country now. You got these churches of segregation going on, right? But if what he said was true, then Solomon never would have said, I am dark, but lovely. He said, I am dark, but comely, right? And other translations, I want to say that King James also says, I am black and lovely. All right. So if a curse was being black, then Solomon somehow was enjoying his curse very well. Right. And he said, and he was speaking this to the daughters of Jerusalem. Right. Four facts Europeans knew about the slaves and why. Here's how you know they knew. They knew slaves were the people of YAHUAH Israel. So they worked hard to hide their identity through race categories, right? They want to tell you science or theories or whatever the case may be, but they knew who the Most High people were, right? It was by design. This wasn't some type of like, you know, well, let's just grab these people over here. Not only did they knew who they were, you keep on reading these notes that I found that are very interesting. Gifted beyond all other people and more capable of enduring the harsh conditions. This explains why they were adamant about using certain slaves to colonize America and the world, right? They just didn't use everybody because the people the world called black are the ones who can endure the harshest conditions. And you know this because history has proved it. We are the ones who endured 400 years of slavery in this country. We are the ones who are still enduring tremendous harsh trials as a whole, as a people, right? We fit every negative category. We lead every negative category in this country and around the world. Fatherless homes, poverty, sickness, whatever the case may be. Divorces, we lead all the categories. However, we haven't become extinct. We are still growing as a people. Kind of reminds you of the time they were in Egypt. And Pharaoh was like, what are we going to do with these folks that are just growing so much? We're going to call them black. No, I'm joking. All right. Three, strong family unity and a crucial part of their resistance. All right. They locked arms. They stuck together. This explains why families were deliberately separated. They understood. You got to understand, you know, when you go in to do anything in a country, whether it's to colonize it, to destroy people, to kidnap them, whatever the case may be, you just don't show up at night and say, all right, we're going to execute. They study for a significant amount of time before they take action to make sure that they're going to win in whatever it is they're trying to do, right? And a lot of that has to do with people they interact with that are sellouts, that are compromised or phonies who claim to be a part of you. They're talking to them, trying to connect so they can get it the inside scoop to help better succeed at what they want to do, right? That is that's a historical fact. I've worked in that area, so I know. Number four, faith in true creator, right? They have faith in the true creator. How do you know? Because they chose to beat people into serving. You don't beat people into serving a true creator. You love and teach them. And you know this because this is the scriptures. This is what we saw the Messiah do. This is what we saw him do when he came. The Pharisees talked mad grease to him. They wanted to siege him. They wanted to kill him before his time. He didn't beat him. He didn't fight him. In fact, when it was time for him to go, Judas gave him a kiss. And Peter pulled out the sword, sliced off the centurion's ear. He healed his ear. You know, he proved something completely different about the faith that we see, that we have seen throughout history, through America and around the world. They force the faith on you. If they force the faith on you, then it's not the true faith. It doesn't align with the Bible, period. Right? So I shared a confession from Hitler that my wife showed me, and it was interesting because I shared it, and it was probably less than an hour. YouTube pulled it down, so I put it on my Rumble account, and then I shared it to my LinkedIn page. And of course, LinkedIn, for the fourth time, I want to say permanently, or right now, my account is temporarily disabled. Right? Chances are it's going to be permanently disabled again. Why would they do that? Right? What does it matter to these people if what we share is not even true? Right? Who's going into the grocery stores and pulling out the tabloids? That's not truth. burn that, right? They don't censor your accounts. They don't pull your videos down, and they don't block you from social media pages or whatever the case may be because you're sharing stuff that just is some kind of made up story, right? So I'm going to read Hitler's confession here. And of all the facts that I just showed you, you're going to see how interesting this confession that he made, right? So Hitler's confession. Hitler said, even in his death, he will start World War III. He said, one of his soldiers asked how. He replied, the day mankind finds out what I was trying to defend this nation, Germany, from then, that's the day World War III will start. On that day, mankind will learn that I was trying to save my nation from the Freemasons, the Illuminati, the Jews. For if America wins the war, then they will conquer the world and forever be a slave to the Jews, and they will try to conquer God, right? But it says, do you know who America has in their possession, right? Before I read the next statement, something just popped into my head. I couldn't stop thinking about earlier when I read this, how the Tower of Babel was created so they can get to heaven. They wanted to get up there to get on his throne. So interestingly enough, he says that they want to conquer God, right? Now, mind you, I probably should have mentioned this before. What happened to the people, the world called Jews, the Holocaust? I don't condone that. I don't believe that was a very nice thing to do. I think it was horrible. However, the narrative behind it is strongly being used to hide some truths, right? So let's keep reading this confession, see if we can find out what it is. So he says, no, the soldier replied, the Americans have the jewels of God. The Americans have stolen God's precious jewels. He said, what do you mean his precious jewels? The soldier asked. Hitler said, America has stolen the Jews of God, his Jews, the Negroes. They are the true Jews. What a foolish move and a direct challenge to God. And they plan on moving these false white Jews into the state of Israel. Now you can see why they took it off of YouTube. America is desperate in an attempt to win this war using atomic bombs on Japan. America will destroy the whole world in an attempt to conquer it. Then it says, when America and the Jewish slave masters conquer the world and the world realizes I was right, then all nations will begin a third world war to dethrone America of its rule. Every nation will soon possess atomic bombs of its own. It will be the end of most of the world as we know it. Why will the Jews control America? The soldier asked. Hitler said, because white Jews know that the Negroes are the real children of Israel, or Yasharel. And to keep America secret, the Jews will blackmail America. All right, last piece. The Jews will extort America. Their plan for world domination won't work if the Negroes knew who they were, right? The white citizens of America will be terrified to know that all this time they have been mistreating, discriminating, and lynching the children of Israel. They will fear God. They will fear God will destroy them as he destroyed Egypt for doing the same thing. So the elite, the Illuminati, keeps this a secret at all costs. Powerful confession that Hitler has made, right? That is said that Hitler has made. Now, when it comes to the talk about the atomic bombs and the world being destroyed, that's not biblical, right? There will be fire raining down. There will be a final battle, a final war. There will be a great chaos that will happen. The Bible talks about that, right? You need a catalyst for the Antichrist to rise and everybody run to him because they want peace and safety. But ultimately, he makes statements about the Freemasons, the white Jews, okay, and Illuminati. And I showed you in history how well-knit this organization is. The people the world call white colonized the world. They've colonized every nation. They've been, you know, you name it, they've been all over the place, and made sure that they landed, you know, wherever they want to land to teach and force whatever they want to force upon people. I don't believe his statement was false. I don't know how much of it was true, but when you take what he said and you align it to what's in history, there's a lot of validity to what he's actually saying, right? The people who the world call Jews in Israel are not the Jews, right? And you know this by one simple fact. They are waiting on Messiah to come in the form of King David for the first time, all right? Second fact is, I want to see if I actually added this in here. I did. We'll get back to that. The second fact is they, what was the second fact? Just slipped my mind here. You know, but they don't believe. The second fact is they are their rabbis tell their followers that they are not to read certain parts of the Bible. They say these are forbidden scriptures. Why would a rabbi tell his followers, if he believed in the true God and the true Messiah, to watch or read only a little bit or leave certain parts of the Bible alone? That doesn't make any sense whatsoever. You need to know all the truth. You need to know the history of the truth. Because if there are certain parts they read in there, not only would they come to realize they're not who they think they are, they would also realize that they're waiting on the wrong person, which is going to be the man of sin who's going to show up. All right? So this is why they called you black and you agree. All right? So when you look at this picture, I've put a few prominent black people on this picture, or who the world calls black. And you got LeBron James, Jordan, Beyonce, Jay-Z, Barack Obama. I even put RuPaul on here, and I'm gonna explain that in a second. You got T.D. Jakes, Ice Cube, Queen Latifah, Oprah Winfrey, Denzel Washington, and of course, Michelle Obama. When you look at this, depending on your understanding of black, depending on your understanding of success, of happiness, of joy, of peace, you probably see success in one of these characters, one of these individuals. You see fulfillment of goals, achievements. You know, the term often is used, black excellence. But when I see this and I look at the Bible, I look at the word of the Most High, I see the very reasons why the people of the world called black, whom are identified through Deuteronomy chapter 28 as the children of the Most High God, I see the reason they went into slavery. I see, excuse me. I see the reason they were scattered among all nations. And here's why I say that. You got to look at their life, right? The thing about these people, they're on the front page. They're on the front news. And these people are showing us ways that are not in line with the Bible, right? They are not obeying him according to scripture. These folks are part of Illuminati. They're part of the Freemasons. You don't ever hear them actually walking out the gospel. All right, T.D. Jakes I put on here because he is a big deceiver. He is a huge deceiver. In my days of being a motivational speaker, I used to be extraordinarily excited to hear TD Fakes or TD Snakes share his motivational stuff with the Bible, with the Bible verses, because I thought at that time I was living contrary. You know, I wasn't fully awakened to who we are as a people for the Most High. And I thought he was sharing stuff that was true. But the true gospel, he doesn't share. It's about repentance and remission of sins. It's not about, you know, your blessing is coming and all sorts of kind of stuff. Because if your blessing was coming and you were supposed to be at this place, then why is Deuteronomy 28 still being lived out by certain people? And you can't say because these people made it because they served the Most High God. Even though they'll get up there and say, thank you, God. This to God be all the glory. This goes out to you, God. You can say that all day long, but what comes out of our mouth, yes, it's a reflection of our heart, but our ways is what the Most High God definitely takes notice of, because he lists tons of things that we should not do. right? That was the purpose of the Torah. That was the purpose of the Messiah coming and living out the Torah, living out the Old Testament. So we know that these things are no longer obsolete. If they were obsolete, then he wouldn't have lived them out, right? Especially being that he was the Most High made flesh and walked and dwelt among us, walked among us. So yes, you may see success and happiness and joy, whatever you want to call it. But here, if you take their actions and you align it to the Bible, you see it's not. And the reason, they called you black and you agree, because you can look at some of these characters and say, you know what, I wouldn't mind being a multi-million-dollar actor or a multi-billionaire shoe owner or a successful politician or a rapper or whatever the case may be. So we pursue after these goals, these agendas, but throughout scripture, it tells us clearly that the people of the Most High God were successful. At the times they were successful, it never was because they pursued success. They pursued wealth, fame, money, recognition, education, none of that. They were successful and blessed because they obeyed him. They obeyed his commands. They live according to his ways. And when storms hit their life, like Joseph, when he was sold into slavery and ended up being lied on and sent to prison, he rose to the top, second in command of Egypt, and was able to save not just the heathens, the Egyptians, but his family from a seven-year famine. Now, if Joseph would have sought success and achievement and education and all these things, trying to be successful, whatever the case may be, he would have not been the example we are supposed to follow after. These people are not. The agenda of black is ultimately designed to keep you from knowing who you are, right? Who are you in the Most High God? A lot of people don't want to equate to the curses, but the truth is, if you want those millennial kingdom blessings, if you want those eternal blessings, then you need to understand who you are and agree with the curses. Why is it that you keep coming up against these storms? Why is it that you go through these different things? Because, you know, I grew up in church and they tell you all the time, oh, speak life over yourself and call those things that be not as though they were, all these taken out of context scriptures and teachings to get you to believe that somehow you can walk out the curses. You can walk past the curses that have come over your father, your grandfather, your grandmother, your great grandmother. You want to do something different. No, those curses are going to apply. And until, the Most High calls his people back to him, right? The scriptures is clear on the prophecies of him gathering his scattered. The scripture tells Jeremiah, and it tells us in Isaiah that he will bring his scattered back from all nations to the land he promised their fathers, okay? The curses, one of the curses with that, they were scattered. So these people that we see and all the others we can think of are successful, quote unquote, and it's not because of their servants to the true living God, but a God of this world. Again, know that by their actions, okay? So, one interesting thing that Most High allowed me to see that I want to share with you guys, it just hit me like a ton of bricks, Revelation-like type stuff, and it was, you know, America and Jezebel. I want to show you guys something here. Right, there's a Jezebel versus churches in Babylon. Right, there is four very distinctive parallels between Jezebel and the time she was on the earth and how she basically tried to destroy the house of Yashareel to the churches of today who are through false doctrine as well as the type of atrocities and killings that happened in slavery by the people, the Puritans, the people call themselves Christians, again, right? There's parallels. Here they are. Jezebel instituted the doctrine of Baal among the house of Yashareel, okay? Parallel, the churches of Babylon, Revelation chapter 20 says, taught false doctrine for the saints, okay? Next one, killed YAHUAH's prophets. Revelation chapter 18, killed YAHUAH's prophets and saints. Seduced the house of Yashareel. Seduce the churches to follow Jezebel's acts, Revelations 2:20, right? What is the punishment that happened to Jezebel? She was swiftly thrown down from a balcony, trampled on, and devoured until there was nothing left to bury. They came in 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 30 through 37, they came to bury Jezebel after she died, but the dogs came and completely devoured her. There wasn't nothing left. I want to say it was her skull and her feet. So there was nothing left to bury, right? You go over to the churches or Babylon, it says that Babylon will be swiftly thrown down with great violence, devoured until there is nothing left to bury. Revelation chapter 18, verse 21. Very, very phenomenal parallels between what happened during the time the Torah was being established, the Old Testament, until the end of the Bible, the book of Revelation, and what's going to happen to the churches, okay? Catholic Church, Baptist Church, Methodist Church, Church of God in Christ, all these churches that came out of the Europeans, the Enlightenment movement, the the Black Boulé, the Freemasons, these were all instrumental in establishing the churches that we have all either grew up in, been a part of, or whatever the case may be. Very important piece, right? This is why the scripture tells us to come from among them, right? So we don't endure what's going to happen, right? This is why Peter also tells us in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1 through 10, he says, therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Adon is gracious, okay? Coming to him as to the living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by YAHUAH and precious, you also, as living stones, being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to YAHUAH through Yahusha HaMashiach. Therefore, it is also contained in the scriptures. Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he who believes in him will by no means be put to shame. He's talking about the true Messiah. He is the chief cornerstone. Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious. But to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders reject has become the chief cornerstone and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. All right? They stumble, being disobedient to the word to which they were appointed. Okay? I'll talk about that in a second. When we finish reading here, it says, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, who his special people, that you may proclaim his praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who was once not a people, but are now the people of YAHUAH, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Okay? This truth here is telling us that we need to come out of the lies. We need to come out of the false doctrine. We need to come out of the ideology of saying that we're black when it's based on, you know, well, Black Lives Matter or Black HBC, Black College. I'm entitled. Give me my benefits. Give me my this, that, the other. The black that we need to represent is the black that's aligned with the word. Right, with the line, with the scriptures, and not what we think about what black is or what we've been told. Because as I showed you through the parallels in history and the establishment of the churches, these churches were never established on the word of the Most High God. Never. Right? They came out of people who thought, more importantly, of philosophy. They didn't consider faith. They thought things were considered superstition. Just because they say Christ or they say they're Christians or they read the Bible doesn't mean they actually stand on the truth, right? And I deal with this a lot in person and on social media. People argue sound biblical facts. It's tell you clearly about turning away from sin, right? Hebrews chapter 10 clearly outlines what happens to people who keep on sinning once the truth is made known. But the churches who were created by imposters don't teach you that, all right? They teach you grace and tolerance and all this other kind of stuff that doesn't actually align. They tell you that God loves everybody, and doesn't matter what you do, you're going to get into heaven, right? So Thank you guys for taking the time to tune in. Thank you for watching. All glory be to the Most High for allowing me to be able to share this truth. To, if it's His will, next week I'll be able to share more, getting a little more in depth. My objective is not to throw a lot of history at you and try to. I'm not that type of teacher. I don't believe in teaching like. Well, the only teacher is the Holy Spirit, and I believe the Holy Spirit gives us the information through Scripture and allow us to see things in the world that aligns with Scripture, so we can prove and disprove the things we experience, the history, the stuff we know and what we've grown to know, or what we may come to know later on down the line. Because the Scripture tells in Revelation chapter 18, He said, everyone who, every liar and everyone who practice a lie will not experience the tree of life, right? They will basically have to go into eternal damnation, right? Not eternal peace. And it's important for us to take the time to be disciplined to go through that word. The enemy is very successful in erecting tons of distractions, social media, cell phones, video games, movies, restaurants, job, whatever, that makes us want to not take that time to sit down and go through Scripture, read line by line. Someone says, you know, because I share a lot of stuff on social media, people typically come out and say, or I comment on a lot of stuff too, and they'll say, well, you know, that's not the truth. Here's John 3:12, right? We just can't look at John 3:12 to try to draw a conclusion or a counter understanding about the Scriptures. We actually need to go into John chapter 3, read the chapter, take our time, look at it, right? Sometimes we got to get to chapter 2, go back to 1, go back to the beginning of 1, go to 4, go to 5. So we'll know exactly what's being said, because He's going to make it plain. He's not going to make you run around with some harsh struggle of, oh, I don't get it, I don't understand, because He knows that you live in time and you don't have eternity in this body. And one day you're going to take your last breath. And the last thing He wants you to do is take your last breath believing that you're black based on what someone told you other than what the Scriptures say. Right? Because that is a practice in a lie. And He hates liars. He hates liars because the Satan, John 8:44, he is the father of lies. He can't stand it. All right. So we got to know and live according to the truth. All right. Hey, again, you guys, thanks for taking the time to tune in. Please share this video. Follow me on Facebook, Instagram. Hopefully, if my LinkedIn come back up, you can check out all my links on my website, williambrooks.org, and you know, follow me from there. If you got any questions, please feel free to comment, shoot me some email or whatever, reach out to me. You know, I'm always about sharpening iron. I'm passionate about the word. I'm passionate about casting down lies. So I may come across real strong, like a nice right hook from a fighter, but you know, I hate lies. I spend a lot of time learning lies, not the truth. Now that I know the truth, I have no problem punching a lie in the mouth, right? With the unadulterated word of the Most High God, right? Hey, Shabbat Shalom. You guys enjoy your Sabbath rest, which is Saturday, sundown Friday, sundown Saturday. Lunar calendar, Hebrew people, described clearly in the book of the Torah given to the Most High God's people, right? Hey, remember,